partly a function of the erosion of old religions, but also as a function of what I've been talking about tonight, namely as the viability of old social arrangements begin to be questioned, then there is a search for alternatives. And the average person, I'm not sure I know what's going on, and probably you may agree, but the average person, none of us are really able to comprehend in any total sense what's going on, and each of us has to find some way to accommodate ourselves to our perceptions of what is going on. And certainly among youth, particularly, there is a disillusion with the social arrangements that have pertained in American society. And when there is this kind of disillusion, then there is the search for alternatives. It's always happened in history. And the alternatives take sometime the form that we must find some kind of new way to organize society, so that you have some youth who are directing their energies to breaking down the old social arrangements in the hope of replacing them with something else, although I would suggest they're not too clear about what they replace them with. And there are other youth whose interests are such that they want to find a solution for themselves and not necessarily for everybody else. And the whole religious movement among youth, including these kinds of odd new cults and sects, etc., that are being generated, I would suggest is part and parcel of what I've been talking about and derives from the fact there is now a growing, more widespread need to find some meaning and reasonableness to make life bearable, and that these movements seem to suggest that they have the answers. So I don't know if I answered your question, but it allowed me to. In other words, I don't know specifically about the Satanic Church, but it fits, I think, into this more general formulation.
Can you speak just a little louder so we can all hear?
In the latter part of your remarks, a series of comments with the disillusion of existing men. And as I listen to the latest remarks you've made, especially those that came as exclusively speech, it sociologically sounds like the building of a new myth. And it occurred to me that one of the things that's troublesome about the social sciences today is their attacks to universities. It's becoming increasingly, not decreasingly, but increasingly difficult to believe that the creature they're talking about is really man. I realize that many social scientists may not be bothered by that problem, but it strikes me that there is a growing credibility gap when the social scientists claim to be talking about man. It isn't clear at all that the claim is indeed a legitimate claim. And perhaps it's just possible that the social scientist is working with within a mythological structure, which is mythological in a derogatory, or if you like, pejorative sense. But as a matter of fact, social science as it is now oriented simply cannot capture all of the essential dimensions that express what it means to be a human being.
Right.
Rather than leading to freedom, we may in fact be unwittingly putting ourselves into a rather sophisticated form of bondage.
I agree with some of what you say. I'm not sure I agree with everything. Let me say what I agree with, because I'm clear about what I agree with. I'm not clear what I disagree with. I think it is the case I would agree completely that social science and science more generally does not produce the basis for saying what are the ways in which social arrangements ought to be. That the whole question of ought is not effectively addressed by any of the sciences. That what the sciences can do is to question some of the assumptions that had supported old oughts, and that's what I'm saying they're doing now, but that as they destroy old oughts, they do not furnish an alternative ought. And what now becomes the great problem is not that science is going to provide an alternative set of myths, as we might call them, by which we should organize life, but it's going to provide us with more insights into the nature of the human condition so that philosophical and theological thought on these matters, hopefully, will be more informed, and that we can then create, hopefully, a society which is more sensitive to all of our human conditions. So I would say, if you're saying that, that's what I heard you say, and I agree with that. I would also agree with that, with what something else that I think you said, but I wouldn't disdain it, which I think you're doing. It is the case that the sciences, and particularly social science, has a strong debunking quality. That is to say, one of the things that social sciences do is to understand human behavior in ways that the actors themselves don't understand. To give a very simple example, if I'm doing research on why people commit themselves to religion, traditional religion or not. Now, if I go and ask people that, they will tell me, if they are believers, why they believe, that they believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, they go to church because they want to worship him, they anticipate a life beyond this life, and they're anxious to get there. Or if they don't believe, they will explain that they don't believe in God because they was exposed to this. Now, as a result of my research, I will postulate quite different reasons as to why some people go to church and other people don't. I won't go into the in depth about that, but I would suggest that, just to be very simple, that certain kinds of needs that people have by virtue of their situation in society produce certain kinds of need fulfillment mechanisms. The church is one of the solutions for these, and therefore people who go to church are more likely to have these kinds of needs, et cetera, et cetera. Now, if I explain that to somebody, they'll say, well, that's a lot of hogwash. I don't go to church for those reasons at all. I go for these other reasons. So there is this debunking quality. But I would suggest that over time, it will be understood, I mean, insofar as I'm right in my explanation, it will become an understanding that these are problems that people face, and this is the way they cope with them, so that as we come to understand that, then it seems to me what is now latent becomes manifest, and I don't know if I'm making this very clear, but that's what I mean by making people free. In other words, it's the more we can know about what controls us, the better off we are. So this is a sort of great, my faith is in knowledge, as you can see. But then what gets used, how the knowledge gets used can be very destructive or very constructive. And that is not, that's how I function as a citizen and you and all of us, not as a scientist. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
The last thing you made is expressed succinctly, the latter part of your remarks, to which I would respond, in a different vein completely. It occurs to me that, in fact, it might be worthwhile for a sociologist to consider the possibility that a society or an individual who persists or who insists that there be absolutely no mystery or be like no ambiguity about his world or about himself, in fact, maybe if you like, bringing about his own defeat, that indeed it could be the case that complete understanding of the self or of society is not truly as beneficial and is really not as freeing as we might believe. I'm not a theologian, I hang around with theologians, and they inevitably corrupt anybody. They corrupt off limits in the world of men is in the better interests of men.
Yeah, well, we'd have to spend some more time together because you're misinterpreting what I've said, because I haven't said anything that is consistent with your interpretation and my judgment. My belief, basically. What'd you say? Why? Because I don't understand you, or? Well, I think it would take too long, but let me just make two sentences. My basic assumption is that as a human being now, not as a scientist, I have to operate from a deterministic assumption as a scientist, because I don't know how else to frame a hypothesis. But my commitment is that each of us is still very much a person of choice, that we act with choice, and that our choices are the better the more we know the limits that are now placed on them. That if we can do away with the scientific perspective on life, by virtue of fact we explain everything that can be explained, and if everything can't be explained by a scientific perspective, which I would argue is the case, then I would say that all sorts of new, then we move into an area where we need new perspectives to try to cope with the world. And there, I think, we'll have a rebirth of some of these disciplines that you now disdain, such as theology, that you partly disdain, and philosophy, et cetera. Anyway, I don't mean to sound peakish about it. I've enjoyed talking to you.
One more question.
Dr. Glock, have you, in your study, found that religion is a form of escapism? You said something in the seminar this afternoon that kind of aroused that question in me, that led me to believe that you were saying that people were using religion as a form of escaping, you know, the hardships of their reality.
Well, religion performs different functions for different people, but I would say that a major function that religion is continuing to perform in this society is a comforting function. That is to say that many Americans who are deeply committed to their faith are very much comforted by this, and that the comfort in part derives from the fact that they are uncomfortable about the fate that life has bestowed on them, so to speak. So in that sense, I don't know, that's in partly, I guess, supporting what you're saying. But it also ties in what I was saying earlier, that if you have a system that ideology alone is not going to support the social arrangements, and that this is a very cynical kind of comment, but that in addition, you have to con people into accepting their social arrangements to some extent. And that in most societies, you have ways of doing this by sort of saying, well, accept the social arrangements and accept these alternatives. So that I would say that the church in America has been one of the agencies in the societies which has allowed for social stability by providing alternative rewards to making life meaningful and comfortable. This sounds terribly manipulative, but I'm not saying there's anybody doing any manipulation. I'm just saying this is the way the world seems to be organized. And that there are other things that also provide alternative rewards and sports and hobbies and all these sorts of things. And that it's inevitable, you see, that we're going to have hierarchically organized societies. I cannot be convinced that we're going to have equal societies. So therefore, if you are going to have them, it's reasonable to try to think through how can we best have them so that those who are not rewarded by the largest rewards that the society has to offer still can have lives which are meaningful to them. And to do this consciously, whereas mostly now we are victims of unconscious forces and we don't quite know what's going on. But if we were aware of some of these things, we could sort of postulate more effectively, I think, the kind of social arrangements which would best bring out the best in all of us. Okay, I better stop at that point. That's a good positive note.
For some of you who do desire to continue some informal discussion, Monsignor Tarrant, do you have an invitation to offer at this time, or are you tired too? Did you hear this again? I don't think they heard you. Would you? And thank you very much tonight, and thank you again, Dr. Glock.
This is University Lecture. Welcome to another in a series of lectures given on the campus of Iowa State University in Ames. Today, Richard Shawl of Princeton Theological School lectures on the topic Technology and Social Change, a New Humanism. Mr. Shawl.
Having had malaria a number of times and being so sick that I first worried that I was afraid that I was going to die and then was afraid that I wasn't, I appreciate technology and what it has done. And I want to make that clear from the very start. But I'm also interested in the fact that at this university, which is dedicated so much to work in science and technology, that there is a discussion going on about the human consequences of science and about the importance in education for the study of science and technology to center on the education of man and his development. What I'd like to do is present a problem that I've been worrying about for quite a while. I suppose I'm almost obsessed with it, and I want to see if I'm off base or not, because if the experts who are here in this area and others of you can convince me that this problem exists only in my imagination, there is nothing better that could happen to me, because then I could go back to the tranquility of teaching theology in Princeton, or what would interest me still more, to return to the beaches of Rio de Janeiro. But if the problem is a serious problem, then perhaps we can discuss it further and try to clarify some of the issues and perhaps see some new light on what is here involved. The issue that I would like to raise is one that, as I say, I've been concerned about for some time, but I was helped in my articulation of it by reading several years ago a speech which Mario Savio gave in the midst of the Berkeley Revolt entitled The End of History. And that phrase caught my mind, and that's what I'd like to focus on. Because I think one of the problems we have today is, how is it possible in the advanced technological societies of the United States and Russia specifically, which are the most advanced, to make room for and to create the qualitatively new in the development of social institutions and structures? Now, I confess that to put the question this way, I start out with a basic assumption. It is that time and again, either our institutions, cultures, and nations go through this process of recreation and reproduction, or else they die. I think this is true even in the most immediate sphere of the movement of culture and ideas from one generation to another. There is no direct and automatic movement between generations in this regard. Our ideas, our culture, our heritage is preserved and continues to exercise a force in our society only as it is reproduced by each new generation. But in the type of technological society in which we live today, in which changes are so fast, the problem is much more acute. That is, in our economic or political order, in international relations, or in any institution, be it a university or the family, new problems arise which require new solutions. New realities call for new paradigms around which our thought has to be reorganized. We face a situation time and again in which new principles of social organization are called for, and new structures of human relationship are the price we have to pay for survival. And as Eugene Rosenstock Huessy has shown in many of his writings, the history of the West is so exciting because, as he puts it, it is the history of revolution. It is the history of the emergence, time and again, of new principles of social and political and economic organization in the last 1,000 years. And when this does not happen, then the inevitable result is decay, sclerosis, and death. Now, I grant you that my choice of this assumption and my insistence on the importance of this may, after all, be due to the fact that I'm a theologian, in which I am forced to focus my understanding of history on the way in which one expects the eruption of the future as an explosive